that fate has brought us here, and we should be together, babe, but we're not. I play it off, but I'm dreaming of you, and I'll keep my cool, but I'm feeling. I try to say goodbye and I choke, I try to walk away and I stumble, though I try to hide it, it's clear my world crumbles when you are not.
Excited to be producing this special segment today. It's going to be a little bit different than what we've done so far. If you haven't seen our previous videos, we've been answering some Bible questions that have been sent in to us, but I wanted to do something a little bit different today. We did a personal Bible study together, and it was biblical advice for young men. I really benefited from it, and I wanted to go ahead and produce this video so that it would be a blessing and encouragement to you. I know there are many young men who follow me and even Pastor Todd, so we just pray this is an encouragement and a blessing to you.
Yes. So we'll begin with Proverbs chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, give some really good advice to young men. King Solomon here is basically telling us why he's writing the book of Proverbs, and he's saying to give subtlety, which means cunning or skillfulness, to the simple. And then he says, to the young man, knowledge and discretion. Discretion meaning good judgment. A wise man, he says, will hear and will increase learning. And a man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsels. So what we're giving you today is not necessarily our advice, but it's from the Bible. It's God's advice to young men.
Right. Right. And this is very important. I personally love the book of Proverbs. When I first got saved, I would listen to an audio of it every night before bed. I just love the way that you have, it's like a father talking to a son. You know, and I've never received that in my personal life. And I know many of you out there either maybe haven't received that. So, I mean, it's amazing that even in the scriptures, our father's talking to us right there.
That's right.
Right? Yeah. And so we have the book of Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Job that are considered like the wisdom books, you could say.
Sure.
Yeah. And I got a lot from that. And the Bible says that wisdom is more precious than silver or gold.
That's right.
You know, so young men, we chase money. You know, as young men, a lot of us try and make it rich, or, you know, we chase things that just aren't valuable. So we should chase and pursue wisdom.
That's right. God's wisdom.
Right. And that's going to put us on the right path. So that, you know, because that's what it's for. It's to help us not, you know, get off the wrong path and to get the most out of what God wants and for us and this life that He's created for us.
That's right. So let's go now to the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 11, verse 9. It says, "Rejoice, O young man, in thy youth, and let thy heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth." The Lord wants you to enjoy your youth. It's a wonderful time of life. You're full of vigor and zeal, and Mario's got lots of that.
Just a little bit.
Since Mario's coming to our church, he's like, Mario! But that's wonderful. That's great.
Yeah.
And God can greatly use that. And what God wants you to do is give that to Him. And serve God while you have your strength in your youth.
Right.
He says, walk in the ways of thine heart and in the sight of thine eyes. Enjoy your life. Enjoy your youth. But know thou that for all these things, God will bring thee into judgment.
Right.
So we've got to be careful, cautious about how we live. We just can't go crazy and do whatever we want, you know, because you can get yourself into trouble.
Right. And that's what you want to do with that energy. Mm-hmm. When it comes up and you're like, right? Yeah. God doesn't want that. He's reminding you here, okay, yeah, you got that youthful energy and zeal, but careful, my son.
Right.
Chill out a little bit.
Yeah, the world's advice is sow your wild oats. You know, have a good time. You know, go crazy.
Right.
Yeah, you better be careful about that.
Right. So God gives a warning here to us. And I think it is important for young men out there, let's take advantage of this energy. I mean, I would love to be this energetic in my 60s, 70s, and, you know, however long the Lord will have me here, but realistically, it's not going to be like that, you know? So, young men out there, let's take advantage of it, let's give all of that to God so that He can use it in an awesome way.
That's right. The next verse, Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse 10, says, "Therefore, remove sorrow from thy heart, and put away evil from thy flesh, for childhood and youth are vanity."
Right.
If we don't do things God's way, we can run into a lot of heartaches in our life, and it can cause a lot of scars in our life. So if we do things God's way, though, we can enjoy life to the fullest. God's people enjoy life when you're doing things God's way. Oh, it's right. Wonderful. It's blessed.
Actually, I'd like to just add, when you don't do things God's way and you're young, and this is my past, you know, I didn't obey the Lord as a teen and all that stuff. It brings destruction. It brings a lot of trouble.
Sure.
You know, the situations that I got myself into that I could have avoided had I heeded the wisdom. Unbelievable.
Right.
So, yeah. if anything, if you're a young man out there and, you know, you're at that age right now where, you know, you can steer that way, please don't. Please don't heed this warning. This is good. I wish I could go back and change certain things and apply this at a young age so that my life would have went in a different direction. But, you know, the Lord has used it and everything. I'm, you know, not upset about that in that sense. But
it's helped your testimony as far as,
of course,
know, understanding where other people are that God can use.
Right. But now He's using me to say, you don't do what I just did.
Don't go that way.
Yeah. I went there, bro. Like, it's not going to bring satisfaction. It's not really going to fulfill. Yeah, it looks fun, you know, the world and all the shiny lights and the excitement that it has. But that sin, that rebellion only is pleasurable for a little while. And the amount of trouble you get yourself into, jail, you can get addicted to drugs, get caught up in all sorts of
stuff.
It's
a high price to pay.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And the Lord wants to prevent us from going down that
path
because He loves us.
He loves
us.
He cares about us, right?
That's right.
Yeah, like a father. He wants the best for you, the very best. So then we go right into chapter 12, Ecclesiastes, verse 1, where it says, "Remember now thy Creator, Don't just think about him when you get old. Don't think, well, I'll make things right with God down the road. Right. You know, right now I'm going to sow my wild oats. I'm going to do what I want to do with my life. And listen, you may get so far from God that, you know, you may get so hardened in your sin that
it's going to be hard to have that fellowship.
It's going to be hard to come to the Lord. Yeah. So don't take that risk. I mean, how do you know that you're going to be able to make things right with God down the road? You don't know. You don't even know if you're going to be alive.
Right.
You could die an accidental death. You could die who knows? Life is so uncertain. So remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them, when you get older and things start breaking down, and use your youth right now for God.
Amen.
So vitally important.
Amen.
So I want to mention just four things here. Number one, make sure that you've called on the Lord to be saved. Make sure you yeah. know for sure that you're saved.
Most
Otherwise,
important.
How are you going to be able to apply God's wisdom to your life fully?
You can't.
It's very difficult.
I think that's important to say, too. These are not just self-help principles mm-hmm. here, mm-hmm. right? This is Holy Spirit-inspired wisdom that God will instruct you with once you're born again and you have the Holy Spirit.
That's right. Exactly.
So it's not a three-step program here to how to be a good young man.
Because you need the Lord to help you
right.
to do right.
That's right.
You need the Holy Spirit living within you to be your instructor, your guide through life, your teacher.
Yeah.
You know, he's the comforter, he helps you, he comes alongside you and helps you and strengthens you. Then I would say number two, not only make sure you're saved, but come alongside a good mentor, someone that spiritually has grown in the Lord, they've matured, and you look up to them. It could be your father, it could be a pastor, it could be a deacon, maybe an older gentleman in the Lord, a saint of God that you respect, and you see by their life, they've got a close walk with God, and say, wow, I want to come alongside them, and I want to learn wisdom from them.
Right.
This is important. Right. Mentorship is huge.
Yeah, I would say mentorship is key. And I know many of you that have been following me for a long time, you've even commented in the comment section the amount of change that just having Pastor Todd mentor me has had. You know, we get together every day, study the Bible, we pray together.
It's awesome.
We last Friday, we went out and served
Mario God. Encourages me. He thinks I'm an encouragement to him. He's an encouragement to me.
That's awesome. You know, and it's just now I have an example. I have someone I can look up to. You know, Pastor Todd's not perfect. I'm not putting him on a pedestal
Absolutely
or anything.
Not.
You know, we don't worship our mentors or, you know, he doesn't take the authority or place of Jesus in my life. Mm-hmm. But I do recognize that the Holy Spirit has sent him to be an example for me, for my benefit. You know, so I can see what it looks like to be a good father mm-hmm. in the Lord, and a good husband in the Lord, and a man
and
who serves God.
You are a mentor to so many others.
Right.
Right?
Right.
So, yeah.
So mentorship is key, guys. So if your father hasn't done that for you, you know, my father didn't. There are men in the local church that, you know, the Lord will send. He'll appoint people to you. Mm-hmm. I believe that.
Yeah.
And they'll be a great benefit to you. You'll really, really grow. Iron sharpens iron.
That's right.
So does one man sharpen another.
Mm-hmm.
And for a young man to come under, you know, the mentorship of an elder who has more experience, understands the scripture more, you know, has had more time for God to work on the Christ-like character, to be an example, the benefit's amazing.
Yeah, it's huge.
Right?
Absolutely.
So definitely a huge recommendation, even from me, I say that mentorship is really key.
Mm-hmm. And then number three, I would say, get involved in a good local church.
Yes.
And if you don't have one, don't know of one, comment to us. We'll try and do our best to help you out in that regard. But it's really important that you be a part of a local church body. You receive
yes.
so much encouragement and blessing from being a part of that body.
Right.
It's very important, extremely important.
Right.
Some people, they think, well, I love God, I know God, and I'll just worship God on my own. And you can to a point, but you miss out on so much.
Right.
You know, the Bible says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. We need
right.
to come together.
It's
important.
It's the habit of some. Some people do that. They don't come together. And that's not what we're supposed to do, right?
Right.
We're supposed to come together. And I think this is important, too, in the context of a young man who has a ton of energy.
Mm-hmm.
Here it is. Here's the place to spend that energy.
Yeah.
You know, this is where you can, it can be an outlet to mm-hmm. all that zeal and passion. You know,
right.
Serving the local church and just loving on people and, you know, evangelism, whatever it is that you love, worship, whatever the Lord has gifted you with, and use that energy, that passion and zeal to really, really, you know, apply yourself and be a blessing to the church.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the church needs the young, fiery, exciting youth. you know?
Yes, absolutely. The young blood, keeps the church alive. And,
and today, it seems like that's a huge missing part.
Oh, yeah, so many churches are dying. They have older people, and there's looks like there's no replacements.
Satan's come after the younger generations, right? So there's even more of a responsibility for those of us who are of this generation to be an example, to really give it to God, to be used of God to influence our friends, to bring them into the church. You know, without us, how is my friend who's in his 30s or 20s going to come to church, right? We could be that person to bring that generation in.
Absolutely. So, get involved in your local church, stay busy for God. The idle mind is the devil's workshop. Be careful of idleness or just even just staying busy doing stuff that doesn't really matter.
Distractions.
You know? Yeah. Get busy for God. Go to your pastor. What can I do? Is there anything I can do? How can I get more involved in the church? Be a help and a blessing.
How can I serve?
You're going to be so encouraged, by being a part of the family of God. And so that leads me to my last thing. And that is stay around the good crowd. Okay, that bad crowd. I mean, you may have the best intention of the world. You want to help your friends or your acquaintances, your family, come to God. And so you're going to encourage them in the Lord, and you go out there and you hang with them. Right. But they end up pulling you down because they're doing stuff that's not pleasing to God. And then you end up going along with it. And then you get discouraged and you get pulled in with them. And it's just, it's bad. So there's got to be a separation there. It doesn't mean you can't still love them, you care about them, you reach out to them, but the fellowship, it's got to change, the hanging around that crowd. You need a good crowd now, God's people to hang around. Make new friends that are godly.
Right.
You need a good crowd.
Right, and what's even more dangerous is if you have a history of doing some of the things that your group of friends is doing, the wrong crowd is doing, don't put yourself there. Don't open yourself up to those temptations. If you used to drink and party with them, and don't go on a Friday night to their house where they're going to be getting together and think, well, I'm going to sit here and I won't drink and this and, but that's like playing with fire.
That's right.
You're going to get burnt.
It's not a good idea.
No. The Bible says bad company corrupts good character. And I mean, just from personal experience, brothers, this has happened to me. I would have the best intention going into this. I'm going to stand for Jesus. Mm-hmm. And, by the end of the night, I've compromised. Mm-hmm. And the enemy's gotten the best of me.
Yeah.
And we don't want that for you. God doesn't want that for you. And tying into what you said before, where you get the good crowd is by applying yourself to the local church.
That's right.
You guys are my new friends.
That's right.
Pastor Todd's my new best friend.
Amen. Amen.
Hang out with him every day.
We'll party for Jesus with our coffee and our Dr. Pepper.
Exactly.
We don't need the world stuff.
Right.
God's people can have a good time.
Yeah.
We can enjoy
healthy good time.
Yeah. Yeah. Good, clean fun.
You won't wake up with a hangover,
right.
Money lost.
Yeah, yeah.
All the stuff that can happen when you play around with that other
bad
stuff.
Bad conscience and just all the things you have to deal with. Oh, yeah. So, yeah, stick around God's people.
Amen.
Find the good crowd.
Amen.
So let's look now at Daniel chapter 1, verse 8. And Daniel's a great illustration of a young man who followed God and was very wise and discreet. It says, but Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself. He was taken into a pagan land around heathen gods and all kinds of weird, strange rituals. And Daniel knew the true and living God. He said, I will be true to him. Oh, we might have young men that would stay true to God.
Amen.
In these days.
Amen.
What an impact.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. More than ever. Just because of the amount of wickedness and the things that you can be defiled by that are just so accessible in this generation.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's important now, brothers, that we do this, that we, like Daniel, purpose in our hearts. And I think that's an amazing thing. You settle it in your heart, that I'm going to not be like everyone else. I'm going to stand apart.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to let God do something special with me. I'm not going to be like everyone else who's just going with the flow and that, I want something special with the Lord. So I think, brethren, more than ever, that this is important. So if you haven't right now, purpose it in your heart as you're listening to this video. Take a moment, pause the video, pray and say, you know what, God? This is important. You're right. I want to be like Daniel.
So
don't you want to be a young man like Daniel? I do. You know, I want to be like all these Bible characters. I think they're great.
Yeah.
You know,
they're heroes.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Spider-Man, Superman.
What's
that
fake.
Nonsense?
Not reality.
Those aren't real heroes. These are heroes. Daniel's a hero.
Yeah.
He can't spling no webs or like whatever or like fly, but he's got real power
with God.
Amen.
That's real power.
Amen.
And you might think, well, if I make a stand and I'm true to God, I'm going to miss out. People are going to think I'm weird. Might lose some friends. Yeah, it may be.
Right.
But look how it turned out for Daniel.
Right.
God turned it around for his good. He was blessed by God.
Amen.
In a great way. So God will bless you.
Amen.
If you'll do what's right.
Amen.
Never forget that. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22, the Bible says, flee, which means to run from, get away from, avoid. It says, also youthful lusts. But follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord. That's that good crowd.
Right.
With them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. So as we get into puberty and the hormones start kicking in and the young man and then we're drawn by the world and all these youthful lusts that come our way, God advises us. We need to run from these things that would pull us away from God. These things we know that aren't right.
Right.
We have to remember, again, as long as we stay within God's laws and His parameters, we'll be blessed.
Amen.
But we've got to do things God's way. And God's not trying to steal any happiness or joy or whatever from you. God made sex. He invented it.
Right.
Okay? And He wants you to enjoy it to the fullest. But you've just got to do it God's way.
Right.
Amen. And so we have some really good instruction in 1 Corinthians chapter 7.
Before you go there, I love this flee, because fleeing, what God's saying here is run.
Mm-hmm.
Like He's saying, that's horrible. Get out, my son. Like, go, go, go. You know, He's not playing games here.
That's right.
You know, it is very serious. And guys, listen, if you're like me and you have a heart for the Lord, you're going to want everything God has for you. And these are things that the enemy is going to use. And in today's society, trust me, I get it. You know, pornography is accessible. Many people listening to this are addicted to it or having a hard time overcoming it.
Mm-hmm.
The stuff that's on television, just modern day music videos today would be considered softcore pornography 50 years ago.
Oh, sure.
You know, so we understand the difficulty, but now more than ever, we need to run from this stuff.
Yes.
You know, it's just as relevant today as it is when it was, you know, when it was inspired to write this back then.
Yeah, treat it like it's a horrible disease or, you know, something contagious. You know, it's just, it's going to bring trouble and sorrow and heartache to your life.
Right.
So, yeah, flee, run from, avoid. Yeah.
Right. Because it might look like it's going to provide that little bit of pleasure, that sin, you know, it gives you that little bit of fun, but ultimately it comes poisonous, right?
Mm-hmm.
That venom will sink in and it'll steal, kill, and destroy what God is trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not what we want for you. That's not what I want for myself.
No. Mm-hmm. That's right. So we have some really good instruction in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 about marriage and how God looks at the sacred relationship between a man and a woman. And we need to do it God's way. As long as we stay within His parameters, we're going to have wonderful blessings.
Amen.
And so let's determine our heart, purpose in our heart, like Daniel. We're going to do it God's way. And the exclusive relationship between one man and one woman, that's what God designed beginning.
Right.
God didn't make Adam with 15 wives.
Yeah.
Right? He could have done that. Right? Would it not have populated the earth quicker?
Actually, I'd like to touch on that, because some people, when they, sometimes atheists or something, will mock the Bible and say, well, God allowed them to marry a whole bunch of people, so how can, you know, because then when you say marriage is between a man and a woman, they use those examples, but what they don't realize is God did that not because it was His original intent,
mm-hmm.
but because of the hardness of their hearts, right? So God's original intent for man was one Adam and Eve.
That's right. One man, one woman.
That's it.
Yep, for life.
Yes.
Yeah. That's God's way.
Yeah, amen.
So the Bible says, verse 1, now concern the things whereof ye wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. And this is concerning, you know, that marriage relationship, and we see that in the context of the scripture. So this would mean, you know, touching that could arouse her in a sexual way.
Right.
So and then verse number 2, nevertheless, or notwithstanding, to avoid fornication or having sex outside of marriage, that sacred relationship. Let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband.
Amen.
So it's just like the law of physics. We've done some awesome things in the past 100 years by obeying those laws. We can do now space exploration, things that, you know, 100, 200 years ago were unthinkable. Why? Because we've stayed within those parameters that God set up. We go outside those parameters, we get into trouble. As long as we obey God's laws, there's wonderful, awesome blessings that come from that. And so we're encouraged here to do it God's way. The world's way, it doesn't bring happiness and joy and peace, an abiding joy. It can't do that. It's just temporary pleasures. That's all it is.
Right.
With a lot of heartbreak in between.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Absolutely.
That's not God's way.
Yeah.
Right?
I had an interesting thing to point on that. Many people maybe saw the video that I made about how I'm going to be trying to abstain from, you know, stumbling and stuff. And you have an awesome story with you and Miss Eva. We have to get this recorded. I think it's just remarkable. Could you tell them about, just, we'll talk about it more in another video,
yeah,
specifically.
We'll give them a
video, Matt. But what did the Lord lead you guys to do when it comes to purity and how you moved ahead with that by not touching and stuff like that?
Well, we knew what God said in His Word, and
right. We
knew that if we obeyed what God said, that He would put a special blessing on our relationship and eventually our marriage.
Right.
And we did it, just obeying God's Word, and God has really blessed our marriage. Now, we don't have a perfect marriage. I don't, maybe there's no such thing, but
no.
it's wonderful, though.
Right.
It's been so special.
And your first kiss was?
At the altar. Yeah, and it was awesome.
Right.
And it was a really awesome kiss.
No kidding.
In fact, we kissed so long that they stopped clapping and they stopped cheering. And then we kept kissing for a while. This was still in the first kiss. And then we kind of stopped and looked at each other, and then we kissed again.
That's cute.
It was awesome.
So special.
Right?
Right.
And it was,
and society would say you're crazy for doing that. You got to try her out.
It was wonderful,
right?
It was wonderful.
Right? They would think, well, that's ridiculous. You know, you should have. You need to try out before you go ahead and.
There's some things that just come natural, and if you do it God's way, He puts a very special blessing on it. It's just so sweet.
Right. So stay tuned for an awesome testimony coming soon.
Yeah,
it'll be a great video.
A video on our how me and Eva met and.
How the Lord did
God led us.
Because I've been talking about this. You know, this is something that even before I met you guys, the Lord placed on my heart that He has a way, you know, and if I were to do it His way, that He would bring that right person into my life, and it would be very special. You know, and then I meet you, and I'm like, they did it! Like, this is the real deal.
Yeah.
You know, so it's a real encouragement to a
living proof of what God can
do.
You.
Yeah.
And not just for us, for anyone.
And now look at both of you are serving the Lord, you know, like the Lord is using you, and that's what I want, you know. Even your daughter, you guys have raised her up. She loves God. You should see this, guys. It's crazy. For 14 years
14.
Old? 14. She loves God. She led one of her friends to the Lord, even recently. Like, that's what I want, you know. So I want that blessing. You're a blessed man, and I want that. And there's a way to do it. Right?
That's right. It's not because I'm anything. It's just a matter of doing it God's way.
Yeah. It's like an equation, a math equation. Like,
that's
He
right.
sets stuff up, and
yep.
if you do it this way,
stay
there's a result.
Parameters, yep.
Right.
And you're blessed.
Amen.
Go outside of that, though, there's destruction.
Amen.
In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4, the Bible says, marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. In other words, God's saying, hey, you get married, you come together in that sacred relationship before me, and you determine that I make a vow that you're going to stick with each other for life. My blessing, my full blessing will be upon you, and you just have a great time. Because, again, God made sex, and it's a wonderful thing.
Right.
It's just to be enjoyed.
He's the one who designed it to feel good, to, you know.
Absolutely.
So, yeah.
It's awesome. God's like, you have a happy, you enjoy yourself, if you do it my way.
Amen. Amen.
And then He says, but whoremongers and adulterers, God will judge. So then let's go to Titus chapter 2 and verse 6, and we'll get into some really good exhortation here for young men.
Before we do that, could we just touch on why it's important to save sex for one partner? Right? Like, the Bible talks about you're sinning against your own body.
Right.
Right? The Holy Spirit is inside of us now, and we're going to grieve the Spirit, right? And it kind of says something along the lines of, you don't want to defile the temple,
mm-hmm.
you know?
That's right. You are the temple of God. And when you're giving yourself to many different partners, you can think of it this way. It's almost like you're taking your heart and you're slicing and dicing it up.
Right.
You know, kind of like a pie, where if you had a cherry pie and you, all these different slices, you know, and you give a piece to this one and a piece to that one and a piece to this one. And before long, when you get down to the one you're actually going to spend your life with, you know, you decide, okay, this is the one. You've got very little left of your heart, you know, and now you've just split it up and your emotional ties have been so pulled here and there, and it's not God's way. It's not to say that if you have done things wrong that God can't still help you and God can't still bless, you know, a relationship that you have if you truly want to do what's right. God's a very merciful God.
Right.
Forgiving. You know, He can still turn things around for our good, and we see that in the Bible many times where,
right.
you know, God can still help us. But there's still some scars there, you know, that we have to live with, and there's going to be some thoughts come in your mind and in dreams and things, and that, you know, because of those things you did that weren't God's way.
Right.
So, right. yeah, if you do it God's way, there's a purity there. There's,
right.
you didn't defile your conscience, and now that, you know, you don't have all these bad things that creep up in your mind and, you know, haunt you or whatever, you know, it's
right.
just, that's God's way.
Yeah, amen.
Yeah.
That's good.
So in Titus chapter 2, verse number 6, the Bible says, young men likewise exhort or encourage to be, number one, it says, be sober-minded. And this has to be has to do with being calm and temperate and moderate, free from inordinate or not orderly passions. So you're staying in control
right.
of those passions that you have, and certainly as a young man, you have a lot of passion, you know. So, and passion can be a very good thing if you do things God's way, or if you use it for God.
Right.
Passion it can be a wonderful thing.
Right.
Just be passionate for the Lord.
Right.
Okay. So that's what it's admonishing us here.
I think it would be good to note as well. You've done a Bible study on sober-mindedness.
Yes. You can see that video as well.
Yeah. So on this YouTube channel, you can go see the Bible study, the Wednesday night that
being
we did
sober.
On being sober. So you can get a little bit more on understanding how do I become sober-minded.
Sure.
Because it's so important, especially for young men.
In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 to 25, the Bible says, know ye not that they which run in a race run all? So we're in a spiritual race,
right.
but one receiveth the prize. So run that you may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery, or to be the very best at being a runner, is temperate in all things. So this soberness is very key. You know, if you're an Olympic runner, or if you're trying to be the best at whatever it is that you do, this goes hand in hand spiritually. And so this soberness is extremely important.
Right, right. And what's cool here, too, is you notice it says, like, it's kind of like give it all, right? It's a mm-hmm. race. You got to go to that finish line and, you know, strive for the mastery.
That's right.
You know, so yeah. come on. We have this energy, brothers. We have that drive, you know. Mm-hmm. We're made to run right now.
That's right.
You know, we're in our prime, so God is saying here, like, go.
That's right.
You know, and you do that by being temperate mm-hmm. in all things.
Yeah, being controlled and calm and your...
Give yourself to being controlled and sober-minded.
That's right. So then we have in Titus chapter 2, verse 7, where the Bible says, in all things showing thyself a pattern of good works.
Right.
1 Timothy 4, 12, Paul speaks to young Timothy, young preacher. He says, let no man despise thy youth. In other words, give them no reason to do so,
right.
to despise your youth. But be thou an example of the believers in word and conversation and charity and spirit and faith and purity. Don't think because you're young that God can't use you to be a great example and a blessing to God's people.
Amen.
God uses youth.
Amen.
He greatly uses youth. We see that so many times illustrated in Scripture. David, Daniel, the three Hebrew men, Joseph, I mean, over and over and over, you know, God uses
right.
youth in great ways.
Right. to be an example.
Don't let that hold you back, or feel like, well, I don't know enough, or God can greatly use you.
Right. And also realize that He is looking for young men to be an example, and there's a responsibility to that.
Yes.
It's to be taken very seriously. Mm-hmm. I think about myself. I mean, I'm an example to so many people, and it puts a big weight on me, and I want to make sure that I do that. I'm in charity. I'm doing things lovingly. It's the right spirit. I'm doing the purity, and setting that good example.
That's right.
For the people that would come into contact with me.
Because you touch so many lives.
Yeah.
We really won't know until we get to heaven one day how many lives we have touched and influenced. So you've got so many people looking to you, especially those that are younger. Maybe your younger relatives or whatever are looking up to you. So, be that example God would have you to be.
Right.
Showing a pattern of good works.
Right.
So it gives us several things here. Number one, it says, show thyself a pattern of good works in doctrine, showing uncorruptness, or not being perverted as far as your doctrine, your beliefs. And 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 17 says, for we are not as many which corrupt the word of God. And so we don't want to pervert the word of God. So we want to be true and have pure doctrine.
Right.
So vitally important.
Right. And what's important there is to study it, to show yourself approved.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so if you're a young man, this is the time, your whole life, but more importantly now, study to get that foundation, to
That's
know
right.
those doctrines.
That's, right.
That's why the mentorship is really key as well.
Yes.
Going back to what we were saying, you're helping me to solidify my beliefs and,
mm-hmm.
and the way that I interpret the scripture and mm-hmm. compare scripture with scripture. Don't agree with you on everything, and I don't think that we're always going to, but the fundamentals and the cardinal doctrines of the faith,
yes.
are so important.
Yes, that you get grounded in the pure word of God.
Right.
So, vitally important. And that you study, as Mario said, so that you might be rightly dividing the word of truth.
Amen.
So that you understand and you interpret the Bible correctly. Very important, extremely important. Then also says, show thyself a pattern of good works in gravity, which has to do with weightiness of character, seriousness. And so many in the youth are kind of silly, or
right.
don't take a lot of things seriously.
Right.
Well, the Bible talks about us being soldiers in God's army. If you know anything about being a soldier, pretty serious deal.
Right.
Exactly.
And, it's not time to play games in a battle.
No, not at all. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth, and we are in a war,
amen.
Entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier.
Chosen to be a soldier. That's
mm-hmm.
cool. I like that.
You're chosen. You've been enlisted
in
God's army, the spiritual warfare.
Amen.
And we're against principalities and powers, and it's just the wickedness of this world. And it's
put on our armor.
That's right.
It's a war.
Yes. So we must take it very seriously. And then it says, going along with that, in Titus chapter 2, verse 7, pattern of good works. Number 3, sincerity.
Mm-hmm.
Having pure motives, coming across as being very real.
Right.
Not fakish or hypocritical in any way.
Mm-hmm.
Very important for a young man.
Yeah, and I think more than ever we live in a generation that's being taken away. We don't have very pure motives in our generation anymore.
Mm-hmm.
We're taught to, it's all about me, and I remember in high school it was all about, if I didn't try and get the most for me, well, I would be left out. Because
mm-hmm.
everyone's going after for themselves. Like, no one's really thinking of anyone else anymore. Right? So it's
sad.
I've even had to, even recently, just check my heart for, okay, how are your motives?
Mm-hmm.
You check yourself regularly.
Why am I doing this?
Why am I doing this?
Yeah.
Is this do I want this, or does the
for
Lord want this?
Self-gain, or am I following God?
Am I being authentic? Am I being real?
Mm-hmm.
Like, these are things that I've been doing in my own heart, even just like the last month or two.
That's good.
And I've noticed the Lord do a work. There is more sincerity.
Praise God.
And I'm doing things from pure motives.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Amen, brother. Praise the Lord. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5 says, now the end of the commandment is charity out of a pure heart and of a good conscience, and of faith unfeigned. That means not fake.
Right. Amen.
And that's what young men need to be portraying.
Right. And then that's key right there, out of a pure heart.
Amen.
You know, and you're going to have to constantly check your heart, guys, every day. You know, check those intentions, make sure you're sincere. You know, it tells us to guard our hearts.
Yes.
You know, watch that. 'Cause if it's...
Right. Don't follow your heart.
Nope.
That's the world's philosophy.
Every Disney movie I watched since I was a kid, follow your heart.
Bad advice.
Yeah. Never led me anywhere good.
You know? Guide thine heart, the Bible says.
Right. Amen.
Guide it in these ways of truth and wisdom that God gives in His Word.
Right.
Then Titus chapter 2, verse 8, going right along with showing a pattern of good works. Number 4, it says, or lastly, should I say, sound speech. Those things that are true and whole, that cannot be condemned. We're to give forth good words. Words that help people.
Encouragement.
Encouragement.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, Ephesians says, chapter 4, verse 29.
Right.
But that which is good to the use of edifying,
right,
building up spiritually those around you,
right,
that it may minister grace unto the hearers.
Amen.
Speech seasoned with grace.
Right.
That's what we need.
Amen.
So we don't just say whatever comes to our mind, or sometimes you have to bite your tongue.
Right.
Make sure you're saying what God would have you to say.
Right.
Let no words fall to the ground. Be a man of your word.
Amen.
Like Samuel, the prophet.
Right.
Right.
Right. And in today's generation, it's the opposite. I mean, kids just, I remember me, I'll just say whatever I'm feeling and thinking. There's no restraint. There's no, I'm actually thinking about what's coming out of my mouth. And that can do some serious damage,
sure,
as well.
Absolutely.
There are so many things that I said as a young man that now, looking back, I would stop myself from saying that. That's not sound speech. That's not edifying to anyone.
Right.
But
not
I
helping.
Would, no, and I would just let it come out, right? So be on guard to that. Know that that's not going to be a benefit to you.
That's right. We all can get frustrated at times, but we need to take it to the Lord.
Right.
Not just, you know, let come out of our mouth, you know, whatever. But let God help you to give out grace and help and edification,
right,
to those around you.
And another thing, too, people, that's popular, especially a young man, is just letting out pride, like, you know, ego, vanity, like all these things just come out of your mouth, and you just watch that.
That's right.
Because it's almost cool today if you kind of, yeah, I'm the man, and you talk yourself up, and it's sad.
No, you know? It's not the mind of Christ.
Yeah. There's no humility there.
That's right. It's not what Jesus would do.
Yeah.
Right? Okay, so we'll just sum it up here. Advice to young men. Ecclesiastes, go back there to chapter number 12. Verses 13 to 14. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter.
Amen.
Two things it gives us here. Number one, fear God. Number two, and keep His commandments. So fear the Lord, reverence God. It's a good thing to fear God. We should be afraid of His judgment and His wrath. And it's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of the living God. You know, one day we're going to face Him. We're going to stand before Him in judgment.
Right. Take it seriously.
That's a fearful thing to think about.
Yeah.
Standing before the Almighty.
Right.
Thank God we have Jesus, our advocate.
Amen.
Right? Our sins are under the blood. What a blessing to know that we're saved. If we've trusted Him. But we need to fear God here and now in this life.
Right.
And think about eternity. Think about the future. One day we're going to be facing Him in judgment.
Right.
Don't just think about the here and now. I'm just going to live it up and have fun here and now. I can do what I want to do. Yes, God has given you free will, and it's a wonderful thing, but exercise it within God's parameters,
Amen.
God's laws. And that's what the second thing deals with. You know, keep His commandments. Be obedient to Him.
Obedience.
There's awesome, wonderful blessing from obeying God.
Yeah.
If you took away all the street signs and all the stop signs and all the stop lights in our town, it would be chaos.
Mm-hmm.
It would be anarchy. Right?
Right.
God's laws are good.
Amen.
They keep us safe.
Amen.
They're a good thing.
Amen.
You know, people look down about a bunch of do's and don'ts and you know?
Mind control, trying to control you.
No, God wants to help you. He wants to keep you safe.
Right.
He wants to bless your life.
Yeah, exactly.
He wants you to enjoy life to the fullest.
Yeah.
And so then we have that last verse, verse 14, "For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil." God sees all, God knows all. Mm-hmm. And everything's being recorded.
Amen.
So let's keep that in mind. And let's be young men that are true to God, like Daniel, and please the Lord and enjoy the blessings of God because of that.
Amen. Amen.
Anything to add, Brother Mark?
Well, that was great. First of all, thank you so much, Pastor Todd,
praise the Lord,
for coming on here. I do have a few things to say in closing. First of all, thanks for listening all the way to this part. If you're still tuned in, we appreciate you taking the time to watch this video. And my heart is really that you would be blessed by this. I was a young man, if you don't know my testimony, who went down the opposite path. I didn't listen to any of this. I didn't heed any of this counsel in my life. Went down the wrong path. And these are counsels. These are advice. This is Holy Spirit-led advice to really get the most out of life. You know, God's not giving us rules and regulations so that he can control us and, you know, keep us in a little box. No, he's given this so we can flourish.
That's right.
So that we don't have destruction and all those things happen.
Yeah,
you know,
heartaches.
Right. You end up in jail. You end up could end up dead from drugs. All these things that could happen to you. Just avoid that. And let us just say no to the world. Okay? Young men out there, let us purpose in our hearts to really give God everything that we have. Take the advice, get active, get mentored, study your word, get your doctrines down, use your energy, your zeal, your passion for God now while you have it.
Amen.
And be an example. And that's what I would really encourage you all to really take to heart, that we have an opportunity to be an example in this generation. And there's going to be younger generations coming up who are going to need us. You know, they're going to need us.
Right.
You know. Yes. And more now, there's going to be less examples in society. Mm-hmm. So there's more of a need for us to take this seriously, you know. So I just pray it was an encouragement to you out there. Stay tuned. We will have Miss Eva come on and do biblical advice for young women. So ladies, we haven't forgot about you. We're thinking about you because even them, there's different counsel for them biblically. You know, this definitely does apply to women as well, I would say. You
Absolutely.
Know, definitely women out there need to purpose in their hearts, obey and all these things, but we'll fine tune something with Miss Eva. That'll be really awesome.
Amen.
And thanks so much for taking the time, everyone. It's always a pleasure. Don't you love doing this?
Oh, that's awesome.
Like, we get to do this for Jesus?
Serving Jesus. It's the best thing in all the world.
Oh, doesn't it bring you so much joy?
No, it does.
Oh, it's awesome.
It
you
does.
Know? And
praise God.
We're walking in the will of God for our lives. So if this can be an example to you, this is blessing. This is amazing. This is the purpose to life.
Amen.
You know, I'm finding real
Helping
fulfillment.
Each other.
Right. You know, I did all that other stuff, the drugs, the partying, the sex, that doesn't bring fulfillment. This does. This does. And that would be so weird to go back and tell little teenager Mario, but 30-year-old Mario gets it.
Amen.
Yeah, this
High
is
five.
The blessing.
Amen.
All right, everyone, thanks for tuning in. Have yourself a blessed and wonderful day.
God bless you.